Here we go. This is what the first slide looks like. Let's zoom out, shall we? And this first slide that we're going to look at today, which is slide 4 of this Davos training bubble chart, trendy looking thing. It's called personal data. Of course it's called personal data. Of course they want your personal data. That's what they want. Their businesses, and they'll give you all of these reasons why they should have your personal data, why your personal data is important. So this slides off with, look, this confused green guy who's saying, oh, what is it? What is personal? Who owns my data? Who owns my data? And he's got like these zeros and ones everywhere, a nine every now and again too. I think that was an accident. He was someone combining. And they really, basically, they patronize everybody. The people who must go to these Davos courses, who must fall for it, must be simple in the brain hole. That's all I can imagine. They are simple. They're simple folk who don't understand why any of this is wrong, why they shouldn't be doing this. And now I talked to a guy, a lovely guy I met on a plane when I was coming over to Chile. And he was from Venezuela originally. And he wasn't that political. He was, I think he was living in London, if I remember correctly. And he was working in personal data, really, in data collection, capture, and organizing the data. So we started having a long conversation about it. And he was like, you know, when you're within this world, you're just processing things, you know? And it can be really interesting, but you've got access to everything. People don't realize. So this guy, you don't know, you know, he's gone through college course, university, and he goes and he starts looking at all your data. And he's got all access to all sorts of data. And so already personal data is in these bubbles, these business bubbles, these realms being used and utilized by people who, well, you can't see what they're doing. A lot of people nowadays are working from home, so you don't even get to see how they're using that personal data. But let's look at this. The first one it says on slide 4 is personal data. Who owns my data? He's thinking that look, the little bubbles, the little zeros, no ones there. He's thinking, who owns my data? And it says it's a hyper-connected world. So it's already excusing the idea that, well, we need your data because this is a hyper-connected world, isn't it? It's a world where we're going to need your data. And so the hyper-connected world, how do we shape the hyper-connected world? Now, already they're saying, look, we're connected all over the place. How do we shape this? How do we shape this? What does how do we shape this mean? Think about it from a Davos, a World Economic Forum perspective. It's saying, basically, how do we control the development of this world, of this technology, of this global hyper-connected world? How do we control it? And so these guys are all about manipulating how you see them using your data so that it looks innocent. You'll see this throughout this slide. So how do we shape this data in this hyper-connected world? And it says, it's got this little, what's that, an oil? It's oil. It looks like it's like the new oil. Data is the new oil. So it's a gas pump by the looks of things. It says, rethinking the digital world. They want to rethink the digital world, don't they? Yes. They're saying technology, business, tactical, legal policy aspects. So think about what they're saying there, rethinking the digital world. So they're saying, well, we're going to change the rules. When they say rethinking the digital world, they're not saying, oh, let's imagine something where we can all work together and we all got to share and things. No, they will have the data at the top and they will use that data against you. So you've got business, tactical, legal policy aspect. So what does that mean? Well, technology. How will they use the world? How will they rethink the digital world for business, for the purpose of business, and tactical use of this data? for business and the legal and policy aspects. Now, a lot of us know that if we want to give up our data nowadays, we tick a box saying, yeah, or we click on saying, yes, approve use of all data, yeah, cookies, yes, all of that sort of stuff. Or you have to go for a load of other things to say, no, refuse them the data, which is something, of course, I do, because that's what, you know, we kind of like look into this world. And what's interesting is that, have a look at this. Briefing in the digital world, business, tactical, legal policy, technology, where's our destiny as human beings? That's a really big question. What's that got to do with personal data? Where's our destiny as human beings? And they've got this little split-brained, it looks like maybe a nose, human there with a halo around his head, which I find very, very weird. I don't know what that kind of symbolizes or why they decided to put it there, but they decided to put it there. So let's go down to who has the right to know. So let's go down to this corner down here. Who has the right to know? So they want to express, oh, you know, train, who has the right to know about your data? And look at this, Bubbles, OS system. So operating services systems system, or OS system. I would imagine that's like, you know, you're using a credit card or something like this. You're using your information in some way. And those systems will need to check your information. So that's understandable. Okay, that's fairly understandable. Public health. Now, that's already worrying, because we've seen over the past 2 years how public health has used our data to coerce people into taking an experimental gene therapy that they call the vaccine that has now turned out to be a failure, a big failure. And they told you at the start, they used your personal private data to market at you that it was safe and effective, 97% effective, 95% effective, 92% effective, 90% effective. Oh, it's only 70% effective. Oh, it's only 50% effective. Oh, there's problems with it. So public health get to use your data, and they've already proven they cannot be trusted. They've proven this. Employers, colleagues, would you want your colleagues to know your personal data? Because when I worked in hotels in the past, you give all your personal data over so you can get this job. You give them your name, your address, your date of birth, all these details about your history, your employment history. And the employers are supposed to keep those records safe and secure in the HR department. So why are colleagues suddenly getting access to your personal data? That's not something that we've agreed to, but it's and the expansion, they expand the amount of people. Like I say, once you wake up, you can't go back to sleep. Once they write in a law saying that that personal data gets used by these people, you can't go back on it. It becomes normalized, you know? It becomes normalized. So this is their root of that, their way of something that you can't go back on. Data aggregator. Of course, those are people who use data to sort out probably statistical, again, cross-company information or cross-sector information. So you do need data aggregators. That's true. In this hyper-connected world, you do need data aggregators. But so far, there's just a couple of options of people who you want to use your data. And then they put the World Economic Forum. Like, the World Economic Forum gets to use your personal data. They're writing the rules. They're the ones writing the rules. This organization set up by Klaus Schwab, who was trained by Henry Kissinger for a CIA-funded course. Yeah, funded by CIA conduits, the American Friends of the Middle East, the Farfield Foundation, and the Asian Foundation. And they want your personal data. And they're already saying that, you know, we should have it too. National security. Oh, national security. Just pull that out the bag. That's been ever since 2001, at least. National security, saying that, trumps everything. It means you can get anybody's data. You can have the right to do anything you like because of national security. Oh, we need it. Because what if they do another September the 11th or something? What if these Arabs do something? If we had all personal data, then we could be checking it against this and checking it against that. You know, there was more than one reason why September the 11th was good for the establishment, why it was positive for the establishment, because they started to implement things that meant they could have access to your data and know more about you. And they were the ones who coerced September the 11th to happen through a multitude of countries and a multitude of actors. Family members. Now, do family members get an automatic access to your data? Is that something that we expect? Who has the right to know? Your family members? Do they? Because most people get on with certain members of their family and not other members of their family. So how is that working? But the more they expand, the more they give data across to people, the more access they have to your data, the more normalized it is to give up the data and then no going back. It's like the waking up. You can't go back from it. It's much harder to go back than it is to go forward. Like with public health, when they enact things and they start injecting people into things, experimental stuff into people's arms, and well, you can't go back on that. You've done it now. You've done it. It's like the waking up aspect. So that's what we got. We wake people up. They put people to sleep in their own little bubble. Okay? So what's the ecosystem we live in? What's the ecosystem we live in? So we live in this world where we're going to need data to be spread around the place. And all these people should have them. But should they? Should national security, should public health have access to all your data? Should colleagues have access to all your data? Should national security be something used as a trump card that you can pull out whenever you want it to be? I don't think it should be. So we're looking at the next bit, which says the beginning of history. Who has the rights and ability to own dash delete data? Now think about that. Think about how important it is. These people who come from what is a CIA-funded organization originally, and has been is all-encompassing, training loads of leaders, that's taking over the world. Literally taking over the world, a global world order. It used to be called the New World Order, but now it exists. It's the old world order now. This is a new generation coming up, and we are under their control. And they're going to be able to have the right to delete your data. So we've seen it, like with Ryan Christian, a last American vagabond. They're able to go around and delete him off the web, delete his PayPal, delete any payment methods, just make him disappear. Who has the right to delete your data? Well, all of them. All of them. They already do. That's exciting. If there's fireworks going off behind, well, enjoy it. Obviously, I've tapped in on something there. So who has the right to delete your data or own your data? Massively, massively important point there that they put through, like, oh, it's just normal. That's just normal. That's it. So that's the beginning of history. They're saying we're starting again, beginning of history. And then we see digital me. They put the digital me. Where is the ethical boundary? Again, asking these questions to themselves. They're not asking to you. They're asking to themselves in their own little closed bubble. Where is the ethical boundary of how we, the WEF, who, if you look over here, look, there you go, WEF owns you, has the right to get into your data as well. So where's the ethical boundary? Well, it certainly shouldn't be with people who you have no association with, you've given no rights to your data, but they're going to use that anyway. And it says, digital me, infrastructure provider. So say broadband provider, say a bill provider or something. It says something like telcos there. Where's the right ethical boundary? Infrastructure information provider. It says telcos. I don't know what that means, but information provider. So people who provide information to the infrastructure provider will be able to access your information. That's really important. Collection, hard to control. Look over here. Collection, hard to control. Use, can be controlled. So you, like I say, I met this guy in Venezuela and he said they're just swallowing up data. They're swallowing up the data. And who has access to that data? Random people who are working at home. They could be doing anything with your data. They could collect that data for something else, for nefarious means. They could be working for another company who's working for another company so they can steal all their data. And that's your data. And it's hard to control. And they admit it. It is hard to control. But the use of the data can be controlled, they say. But that'll only be for a limited amount of time, obviously. Obviously, a limited amount of time. And they kind of say that here. Oh, we've gone too far there. Press the button by accident. It says, the next bit says, we are at a moment of a tipping point. So we are at the moment of a tipping point. Okay. Oh, good. Did it again. That's so annoying. Let me move this so we can see, and hopefully you can see, and hopefully I've moved the my own face on there. So think about this. We're at a moment of a tipping point. They're saying things like the beginning of history. We're at a moment of a tipping point. And we've got to switch perspectives. Data owners needs to care about customers. So data owners needs to care about customers. I'm not sure if they should have pluralized the needs. There's loads of little mini mistakes in these slides. So sometimes spelling mistakes, but sometimes grammatic errors. But data owners need to care about customers. But data owners don't care about the customers. Do they care about? They care about the data. You become data. You become zeros and ones to these technocrats who want to eventually turn you into a cyborg where your mind would work only in zeros and ones. Think about that. You will eventually be the data, physically be the data. Understand, they're creating an ethical backbone for a transhumanist ideology at the same time that they're implementing it by saying, oh, look, this is your data, you know, who has access to it? Eventually, it'll be who has access to parts of the things inside your body that they're putting inside your body, the chip in your brain or the scan thing in your arm. Who has the right to that data? Well, it's in you. Surely you should be in control of all that, but you won't be anymore. Because you see, they'd be able to switch those off. Like they can switch Ryan Christian's PayPal off. Think about that. Very important. So data owners need to care about their customers, but we all know they don't care about their customers. So how do they collect and use our data? That is the thing right at the top there. How do they collect and use our data? Well, they use and collect it however they need to make a profit. And that is one of the biggest problems with giving these people your data. So we're getting through this one quite quick, and we have to get through this one quite quick, really. Now, here we go. Look at this. So we get over to here, just underneath this dark. So I've skipped around all the way around the outside, and we've come to here where we're on trust. This is something they want to do. They want to make you trust them. But we know that you can't trust them. So what does all that mean? See through data. That's one of the things they say. See through data. Like a transparent data collection, I suppose. Trust. See through data. But then they got this all-seeing digital eye in the middle. Again, this is the second slide. It's got just an all-seeing eye in the middle, which of course is going to leave people with questions, because no one trusts these guys already. They already think or know that they're part of an elite system that worships something different than what has ever been seen in the past. It's always very suspicious. And it says here authorizations. Now again, spelled in an American way, yet lots of it is also spelled in the British way, so you wonder who writes these up, if it's written up in separate places, or if these people are just foreign in some way. A lot of people, if you go to France or Germany, people will say, oh, I learned English, and other people say I learned American because they went to America. So they'll see America American as different English, which is right because it's got the Z's in, and you know, in things like authorization. So you've got slight differences within the language, how it's made up. But this authorization transparency is vital. See, big exclamation mark! Transparency is vital. For them, transparency is exactly what they need. They need to be able to see all of the data. But for you, they're trying to frame that as, oh, you know, it's important that these companies are transparent about what they do. Otherwise, you won't be able to gain the trust. The trust is in the middle. So you need to, transparency is vital. But a lot of these sentences they say, or these words or these terms they say, can mean two different things. It can mean multiple different things. Authorizations, data sharing. So already you've lost control of the data. If you're sharing data and there's one company over here who needs to share with another company, then they share with another three companies, and they share with another three companies, etc. Your data is in the ether. And that's what they want. They want access to all data. Because then, when we go back across to here, national security and public health can use that to be able to work out exactly who you are, exactly what you're going to do. They will be able to manipulate you psychologically without you even knowing it's happening, because they know how to do that already. That's common knowledge for years, how to motivate you to do something by doing something else. And that's what they want. And they need you to trust them at the same time. And it says universal rules. Now, that's perfect for them, isn't it? For the global world order, for the new world order, to have universal rules. And that doesn't work in my mind. There's loads of different countries all around the world. There's loads of different countries who all have different cultures, different behavioral patterns, different expectations of how things like data is going to be used. And these guys say, oh, we want universal rules. Well, we do that, and it's a slippery slope where the power over our lives is somewhere really far away in a dystopian land where all of the elites live, and all of the schmucks live elsewhere in the deserty dirt lands and the wastelands around. So what I'm saying is, you can't bloody trust them, can you? So value. How do we measure the flow? How do you measure the flow of data? How do you measure it? Well, you don't. It's nearly impossible to measure the flow once it's come to a certain point. You know, they have their statistics, and what they're aiming to do is eventually everything gets taken over by computer and technology and becomes quantum. And as they say, you won't understand why a computer's making a decision. Well, how do you measure the flow of something you can't understand why the decision is being made? How do you measure that flow when you don't see how it's being used? This is impossible. This is pie-in-the-sky stuff, really pie-in-the-sky stuff. So it says a collaborative security path. So they're saying, oh, we've got to come together and have a collaborative security path, yes, so that everything, all the data is safe, and that only these people like national security and stuff and the WEF can have access to that, because it's a collaborative security path. And here we see already something. We can control risk by agreements. Legal. This is a legal aspect. We can control risk by agreements. They can control. So who's in control of your data? Who has the right to decide how your data is used? Well, it's them. It's not you. They're taking that away from you. They don't want you to have control of your own data. That is not what they want. So eliminate tensions. What does that mean? Eliminate tensions. I don't agree with you using my data like that. Well, legally, now we've written into law, so the tension's eliminated. Well, I'm going to rise up against you. Okay, we're going to lock you up. You know, that's the system. Eliminate tensions. I don't trust it when these globalists say that, because eliminate, what does that mean? Anyway, that can be a conspiracy for another day, obviously, in itself. That's with a lot of these words, how they say things. How can we create multi-stakeholder bodies and drive sustainable outcomes? How can we create, and this is the last part of slide 4, The next two slides we're going to look at are even bigger and more complex than this. That's a really interesting one. How can we create multi-stakeholder bodies and drive sustainable outcomes? So there, stakeholder, multi-stakeholder. Now, multi-stakeholder means big businesses at the top. We're using it with banks and using it with everything. It's not about you. You don't have a stake in this society at all. And you'll see this later on. They're not going to come to you to find out what you will allow them to do. They're going to come to you to say, oh, let's talk about it. And you're going to talk about it, and they're going to do it anyway, whether you like it or not. And they're going to use multi-stakeholder bodies and drive sustainable outcomes. What's a sustainable outcome? It's one that they know will keep working every time. So that has to have one basis where if 40% disagree with how it's done, they're out of the picture because they won't allow the drive of sustainable outcomes. You need to have sustainable, you need to have reoccurring processes that are the same every single time. And that, this I find worrying, this whole personal data, everything on here. Who owns my data? Who has the right to delete my data? Who has the right and ability to own or delete my data? All of this is really massive stuff, and we really don't understand. But behind closed doors, the World Economic Forum are deciding how they're going to steal your knowledge, your life, your details, your data, and use it for their profit. Not for your profit. No. You're going to end up owning nothing and being happy while they own everything and own all of your data too. So you can see why we're going through this.
Shaping a great reset for the post-corona era.